I turn it over to Cindy, and she's going to walk us through a few additional pieces of business.
Okay, and maybe what I'll start off with is just making sure that we have all the materials. There's four items that you should be working with or referring to as we go through this piece, in addition to the binder itself. So you should have your proposed final Delta plan.
This is the packet, which mine is blue line, not red line, but the import is the same, right?
Yes. Okay. So red line is those items that have been deleted. Blue are the new, the new text. You should have a copy of the revised executive summary, and this is, again, in track changes. And red is new, red strikeout is the deleted text, and green is where text has been moved within the document. Some color coding guidelines here. And then in the binder itself, you should have an errata list for the proposed final Delta plan.
We do.
Okay. And then, of course, the resolution, which has not changed since this original, but I know we're double checking to make sure. So.
The errata list is attachment 3 to 6B. I think it's just one entry. And there have not been any additional technical corrections found since?
No, not since the generation of this attachment.
Okay.
So.
Two items, I guess. Three items.
Three items. Yes.
Okay.
Okay. And so Dan did a great job introducing this item, and I think maybe I'll just quickly take us back to the March meeting and just do a recap of what we have done per council direction since March, and then we can launch into question and discussion on these documents.
Right.
So as you recall, in March we came to you with a report on and a summary of comments we received on the final draft Delta plan that was released at the end of November. And though we did not have a formal public comment period on that final draft Delta plan, we did, of course, receive comments. And staff reviewed those and analyzed them and summarized and the ones that we felt we needed to bring back to the council for discussion. So we brought a council action change.
And the narrative surrounding policies would be consistent with the council directed changes to the regulatory text and the rulemaking package. So what you will see in this proposed final Delta plan are those conforming changes to the policies, to the narrative, language surrounding those policies, the 39 items the council did approve off the consent checklist with several modifications that the chair mentioned.
They are reflected in the report.
Yes, they are. So those are reflected in this track changes version. And then there were some additional items we'd asked council for approval to give us some discretion to make some formatting corrections and typos and things like that. So there are some changes like that in here. In March, we introduced the idea of, or reintroduced, I should say, the idea of a revised executive summary. This was an item we discussed with the council many months back and received direction to move forward with revising the executive summary to make it a more standalone document,
very readable story. And so we came back to you in April with the actual document itself, the revised executive summary, and we walked through that document. We received some comments at the meeting itself from council members as well as members of the public. And then we had about a 5-day window, I think we gave folks till May 1st to get us any additional written comments in. And we did receive two letters with written comments on the executive summary. And we went back, staff went back, working with John Hart, and I should say Mr. Hart is here again today. And he was with us at the April meeting to answer questions and kind of walk us through the revised executive summary. But we got back together, took a look at all of the comments, made revisions, circulated it amongst staff a few more times. And what you see today is the result of the revisions that have been made for those comments. So I think John given me a nice list of the major changes. I can run through them in the executive summary if you'd like. Or we can launch into discussion on the revised documents.
My guess is you're just going to start working through the material you've got in front of us. Is there any questions, of course, on the part? Unless the council changes something, the motion that's being presented would approve the elements with staff recommended changes. And anything the council would suggest on top of that.
Yes.
Versus.
And we are recommending packaging, obviously.
Yes, right. Okay. So, do you want to start with the executive summary?
Sure.
Okay.
I've been harping on the importance of the executive summary for 3 years.
You have agreed
on that. This is what most people who pick up the book will read, and that's all that they will read, and how important it is to put everything in here. I'm just looking, and I must have missed this in an earlier version, but in the first paragraph, the second line from the end of that paragraph starts out with Stewardship Council with a mandate to resolve long-standing questions. It sounds to me like a mixed metaphor. That's our mandate. Don't we resolve issues and answer questions?
Oh, where is John Hart? He was right here. Get up here. Mr. Hart?
I warned him he might need to come up here.
Yeah, he was trying to avoid the anguish of this, but unavoidable.
Didn't work.
Here, John. Why don't you grab your name tag too? It's right there.
This is on the introductory paragraph in the next to last sentence. Mr. Nordhoff was suggesting that we don't resolve questions, we resolve issues or problems or something like that. What's your reaction here, Mr. Hart?
I would be perfectly happy to make it issues.
Okay. Mr. Nordhoff? Okay.
That is our mandate, isn't it?
Yeah, I agree.
And that's pretty important.
Yeah. I agree. John, I've always liked the tone in which you write, but I like this. This is the closest we've come to simply explaining some of the complex things we're doing. And it's helpful. It's helpful.
Thank you.
Questions, members, on these drafts and changes? Mr. Johnston, did you? No? Don? Okay. Here's a suggestion. If you're still looking through it, and of course, you had an email of the changed document. We can circle back to this. Would that be okay? All right. Let's say, John, don't go away, but let's get through some of the other stuff first, and then we'll circle back while members just check to make sure on their understanding of this. What's next? Ms. Messer?
Well, I think next would be maybe we'll walk through if council members have questions or comments on the proposed
overall plan.
Yes.
Okay.
And then we can wrap it up with the errata.
Okay. We'll come back and wrap it up with the executive summary.
Okay.
On the plan itself, members, if you grab your copy, how do you want to...
I'm sorry, Pat. For clarification on the executive summary, what happens next with this red line?
Well, unless there are changes as similar to the one Mr. Nordhoff just made, we give in our resolutions directions to staff to make final editing, grammar, spelling, understanding changes in the whole Delta plan. But we then come to the point where we take, vote yes or no on the motion on the Delta plan.
And this is part of it at this time?
This would be part of it.
And just speaking of the executive summary, policies nor the recommendations, but the description of what we're doing. Will staff or the author work with it further, or just what we decide?
Well, I mean, obviously, if the council directs a change, because this is the council's work product, that change will be reflected. But my expectation was that if there are grammar or editing suggestions, that's something the staff and Mr. Hart are going to have to work out without us trying to rewrite it. I mean, the executive summary is just that, an executive summary. It is not a regulation. It is not legally enforceable. It's an explanation of
a
more complex document.
In reading it, staff would have the latitude, even if approved as part of the Delta plan today, to make stylistic or
yep.
grammar changes, right?
That would be correct, yeah.
Yes.
And how would you characterize resolving longstanding issues?
Copy editorial. Copy editorial, and certainly within the purview of staff's ability to clean up minor glitches.
With input from council members?
I would, yes.
Mm-hmm. I mean, we've been over this thing so many times, but I must admit this is the first time I've seen this version of it.
Well, that's why what we're going to do is go to the full Delta plan and then circle back at the end of that discussion to the executive summary.
And when will that be? Today?
Today.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right now.
But I still would not have had enough time to read the damn thing.
Well.
Well, here, okay. My goal today, if it's at all humanly possible, is to try to get through all of the elements, the Delta plan, the rulemaking procedure, and get instructions if we can, although we have noticed a meeting for tomorrow as well. If we can't get through all the work, we'll come back tomorrow to finish up, which is certainly would give you the time you need.
This is the only thing that I haven't been through. Everything
yeah,
else
okay.
is fine with me.
All right.
So either I read it while you're discussing everything else,
yep.
or I do it tonight. Your call.
Why don't you do this. Take a fast look at the changes that have been there during the discussion on the Delta plan, which I know you have read. And as we go through that discussion, you'll get a better sense as to whether you think there are major problems or you have major questions or you just want more time, and we'll deal with it then. And it might be even possible to come back solely for the purpose of the executive summary tomorrow.
Mr. Chair, I would just say that I'm kind of in the same predicament as Hank. I've gone through a lot of this material, but this may have been emailed and I didn't pick it up, but the rewritten one, and again, we had a chance to weigh in last council meeting to talk about that, but if we're going to pay due attention to what they're telling us now, I mean, you're suggesting, well, we maybe pick up some of the keys in on it. But I did note just in my brief few minutes you're looking at, there's an item on page 6 that goes to, if I could just turn us to that, I mean, I'm going to ask our staff to look at this, and goes to, and John's taking this from our document, so this isn't, again, this is not the writer so much, but he says on the very top of that page 6 in this handout, says, first of all, the council is to coordinate. Next sentence, it will chair a high-powered committee dedicated to implementing the plan. The heads of key state agencies will be at the table together with federal representatives. This body will meet for the first time in the fall of 2013. Agency staffs will work with that of the council daily. And it goes back to the request that was made by party from the audience, but one that I think certainly was responded to. Mr. Ray said he thought that the DPC might be a part of the implementation committee. I think you've got a high-powered agency. That's been part of the problem in the Delta, very frankly, is that everybody plans for it, but they don't include the folks that are actually there in any really meaningful planning or decision-making, and that's been a complaint about BDCP. I would grant that the DPC certainly could reflect some of that, but this goes back to the request, and if we say this in our executive summary, then that's what's taken to be.
Isn't it, and you think it's the reference in the Delta plan to agencies, my recollection is, includes mention of, I'm trying to remember that, the Delta Protection Commission.
Well, it does say the commission, but there's been a request that maybe some of the other entities, again, you can't be too large or otherwise you won't have productive, but if you get, if state and federal agencies planning the future of the Delta, then, and again, I don't want to argue this point so much today, but we're going to have, as Chris said, or told me earlier in the week and Cindy did, they're going to be back in June with a discussion about that. I think, though, if we embody this in the plan, and then we just, again, I think it maybe sends the wrong message, not that the implementation committee wouldn't contain those folks. And, again, I think John's characterization, that was his take on this, a high-power committee, once again, state and federal agency planning the future of the Delta. And not that the DPC was excluded, but that's one voice, and I think that there may be other voices we want to include and have them, too, be available to work daily with council staff on issues that are critical to meeting the political goals and to the future of the Delta. So, again, I don't want to make too much of it because this is a summary. I think John captured it, but if we're going to have a high-powered committee that's going to implement this, then there needs to be local representation, I believe, if we're going to be effective in carrying out what this plan, has details being some of the goals.
If I might, through the chair, this issue is also discussed on page 48 of the Delta plan, which refers
Chapter 2.
Yeah, which refers only to a committee of agencies who are responsible for implementing the plan. And so part of the
That's the statutory language.
Yeah, part of what we've referenced repeatedly is that the importance of having being agencies that have got implementation responsibility. But then in further down in describing the membership of the committee, it says, and I'm on page, now I'm on page.
Page 49, line
49, yeah. The implementation committee will include federal, state, federal, local, and state agency representatives as dictated by the specific matter or subject area of the Delta Plan. And so it goes through and lists agencies. The DPC and the Conservancy were the primary agencies with large local participation that were listed by name. But then it does say on line 27 that others, as appropriate, will be invited to participate. And I think, again, it partly depends on what interest other partners have and what their role in implementation of the plan is. So I don't think there's an effort to exclude locals from the committee.
Mr. Knopf.
Mr. Chairman, if it serves the council's purposes, we could separate the executive summary from the decision and from the motion.
Well, look,
to give more time.
If unless there is a fundamental kind of policy question, the phrasing questions, the emphasis stuff, I think we can work out by moving through it. I was going to suggest, again, because Mr. Nordhoff wants some time to look at it, let's do the Delta Plan itself first and then circle back to the executive summary, decide at that point whether we want to put that over for a day or not. I'm loath to start carving pieces of the Delta Plan out and saying, oh, we'll act on them later because we have a question.
Mr. Chair, I guess I just would offer a suggestion for executive summary if you want to circle back on it, but that your committee would be much more powerful if it had local representation, and I think maybe that's submitted to in some of the background documents. I think it ought to say that in executive summary.
Well, it does. Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, an executive summary.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, that's the point on that. But
well, members, I don't object to that. Could we leave the drafting and the language to the staff and Mr. Hart? Don?
Well, yeah, I think you can do that. You know, I mean, there's a way to do it. He's got it, says it. You can add, you know, you can leave the drafting to it. I guess before afternoon's out, if there's a willingness to accept that, he's a pretty good writer. He could probably tell us right now how he might insert that. So,
well, I would add that what you're bringing up, Don, is a substantive change in the intent of the implementation committee, and it's one that I think deserves some careful consideration, and not to make that change by inserting it into the executive summary at this point.
Say that again? I don't understand.
Adding public involvement, just leaving it hang there like that, is a different intent of what the legislature described as the implementation committee. It was supposed to be the agencies that responsible for the Delta, and public involvement was intended to be through representation from the Delta Protection Commission. Now, that's not that we have to stay that way, but there should be adequate discussion to figure out how to do that.
If I might add more confusion. It's my understanding that the implementation committee will be a committee that meets once or twice a year. It will consist of the goal. It would consist of the highest level representatives from state and federal agencies, the Delta Protection Commission, and the Conservancy. The DPC and the Conservancy would serve as a role at this high level of representing local interests. Then, as the implementation committee identifies plans or projects or actions that require coordination among the multiple agencies and local interests, there would be work groups assigned to each one of those. And it's at that level that the stakeholders, the local interests, the counties, the cities, the agencies, the various science disciplines that come into play with whatever that particular work group is dealing with, will be working weekly, daily, hourly, whatever the time and frequency requirements are, to report back to the implementation committee. The implementation committee essentially will serve as a forum to highlight inaction, uncooperative activities, and try and resolve those. But where the rubber hits the road is going to be in these work groups. And it's my understanding that would include every interest at every level.
Let me just read the statute to you again. Water Code Section 85204. The council shall establish and oversee a committee of agencies responsible for implementing the Delta Plan. Each agency shall coordinate its actions pursuant to the Delta Plan with the council and the other relevant agencies. I mean, that's the statutory language we're working with. You know, no names. I'd argue that the fact that we've got this other structure which says that covered actions are state and local agencies are required to be consistent with the Delta Plan suggests that it is at least arguable that it's only state and local agencies. But we've already talked about the need to bring the federal agencies in, at least by invitation, because so many of these things are connected to what they do or don't do.
You know, Mr. Chair, I would just say, too, that as you think about that and maybe get down to a more micro level, but, you know, reclamation districts, they're responsible in good part for levies that, you know, that's critical to the Delta on a minute-to-minute basis. You know, I think the water agencies, North Delta, Central, South, maybe others, that, you know, in certainly cities and counties, it may be incorporated in their general plan, but they're going to be responsible for certain aspects. And when it comes to covered actions, as I heard this morning on the environmental, the MMRP, that floats back down to the local entity, whether state or county, to make sure all that gets enforced. And if you're going to be talking about big items or small, again, I don't know how you I'm not getting into the construct. I just think that, you know, as well and fine as you have a representative from the Conservancy, DPC is kind of the notion that we're thinking about. I think you got to bore down more. If you want to have an effective implementation of this plan, I believe you're going to, you know, because you're going to depend upon the locals to be consistent, to make sure that things are done according to Hoyle, at least those levels in which they're having projects and or considerations, i.e. state agencies, federal agencies to be responsible in a like fashion, but they get to be on the super committee and the other folks get to be over here just doing what the plan tells them to do. And I don't want to mischaracterize it, but I think that is a key piece. And again, we won't necessarily decide today, but I think it's key.
Well, perhaps the
Mr.
staff
Fiorini.
Could...
versus the committee structure. Yeah.
Mr. Fiorini. Oh, I'm sorry, Ms. Gray, then Mr. Fiorini.
You know, one of the things that I think all of us have heard throughout this whole duration of 3 years or whatever is that it has been important to have local input, stakeholders' input, and so forth moving forward. And I think Don makes a good point because if the executive summary only refers to the state and federal agencies, which are responsible for implementing certain things in the Delta, but I also think that there could be a statement in there that says what Randy had talked about, work groups will be established per project or whatever the language may be that will include local representation, key stakeholders, and I don't know if you want to say to address other issues or projects or whatever, but I think you can put that in the executive summary. That does say
We can put general stuff. If we want to specify and shape our behavior, we have to put it in the Delta Plan. And I remember the discussion that happened. There are 5 counties, 20-plus cities, minimum of 80 local agencies within the jurisdiction. You're already starting from a base which, if everyone's involved, exceeds 100 people.
But, Mr. Chair, can I finish my comment, please?
I'm sorry.
Thank you. I think what you're saying there includes a lot of folks, but I just think that moving forward, we should acknowledge that. It will include a lot of folks, is what you said, but I think it's important that that summary, although it's in the Delta Plan, which I think was stated, but I think the summary should reflect that information to some degree.
You know, Mr. Chairman, this is much about perception as it is about reality. Folks are going to read the executive summary. Reporters are going to read it. They're going to tell other people what's in this plan. They're not going to look at the plan. If we can get clarity on this issue that's been raised by Don with a simple statement, I would incorporate it in the executive summary. It just makes more sense to me from a standpoint of public information. And it's a matter of perception.
Mr. Hart, perhaps I could be educated a little further as to who exactly will make up
the implementation committee,
the problem. If we know.
The council's decision is, and Randy is going, you know, has agreed to serve as the chair of the implementation committee. How big can it be and still be effective?
How about the phrase local agencies or local participation? It doesn't have to be extensive.
Well, I was kind of hoping the Delta Protection Commission serves as the umbrella for all of this. I mean, that's...
Yeah, I don't discount that, but I mean, you know, I'm not an expert. Let me tell you, the state agencies are on a Delta Protection Commission as well, but they're going to have a separate, you know, call out here. They have agencies that are party to these actions that sit on the commission. But I understand the dilemma again about numbers. But there's a way to figure that out. I mean, legislatively, they did it, you know, about calling out for, you know, the constitution of the commission, for example, and you know, the construct of this council. And so there are ways to do that. I don't expect to do that this afternoon, okay, or today. But I do think, and maybe as Jeff Damrell said, that maybe you call out local agencies, and that way then you're going to, because again, I trust we're going to come back, but once it gets built in the executive summary, and if this is the reference point, then I think it's easier to argue to say, well, you know, that's how you had your chance to do that. This is the way we're going to proceed. We're interested in hearing from the DPC or from the Conservancy. So I guess, Mr. Chair, I don't have the solution as we're talking about this moment, but I do think that there's a way to phrase it to beyond just the committee structure. I think committees are great. That's where you get a lot of the work done. But the high-powered body that's referenced here that's going to be doing that day-to-day, making, I guess, some, you know, give strong direction, if not decisions, I think it's important for to have that, again, as appropriate, to have that representation there on matters that affect the local landscape and water transfer and everything else. So.
Yeah, and then again, just as a reminder, the executive summary is derived from the Delta Plan, and the Delta Plan itself in Chapter 2 on page 49 in lines 14 through 28 describes what was at the time when the Delta Plan was, this first part of the Delta Plan was drafted last fall, was the thinking about the membership of the implementation committee. And it does recognize a role for local agencies, but it's not clear on who that would involve or what that might be.
Mr. Fiorini.
Well, we obviously have more work to do to organize the implementation committee, the work groups, and how that's going to operate. But I think it's important that the executive summary reflect what's in the Delta Plan. The Delta Plan cites that locals will be involved somehow, to be determined. Simply inserting something to that that reaffirms that in the executive summary would be the way to approach it.
That should be easy enough.
Okay. All right, Mr. Nordhoff says yes.
Just a question of process. It looks to me that we just have item 6 to complete, the Delta Plan and then the
rulemaking.
Summary.
Yeah, and the rulemaking.
Are you not scheduling a meeting tomorrow?
Well, it depends on whether we can complete the work. I mean, the practical work is to pass, as staff proposes, two more motions. One, the one we're talking about now on the Delta Plan and the changes, which includes the executive summary. The third motion, 2013-3, is on the rulemaking procedure, which is the extract from the Delta Plan of the regulatory elements. And if we get it all done, that would be terrific. But if we can't, we won't. We'll come back tomorrow.
Yeah, it looks likely to me that we don't have to meet tomorrow just for the executive summary, just because of the importance of it.
Maybe, yeah.
And this was resolved by mentioning local participation, because there's nothing that would be inconsistent between the executive summary and the plan itself. Is that the resolution to this issue?
I think so. It really depends on Don's view. Do you have to list...
No, not an executive summary, but I think...
How about in the Delta Plan?
Well, I may anticipate your question. I don't list everybody by name or reference by entity. I do think you need to, in the executive summary, have that reference to local participation agencies. And then your Delta Plan, beyond what it has here now, just talks about DPC and Conservancy and a whole host of other state agencies and federal agencies that are likely players. So I think it's kind of dual, Mr. Chair.
Here's what the Delta Plan says, line 16, 17. The implementation committee will include federal, local, and state agency representatives as dictated by the specific matter or subject area in the Delta Plan. At a minimum, the implementation committee will consist of, that's where the Delta Protection Commission is mentioned, and I think the Conservancy as well. It's open. It doesn't say those are the only people. It just says, for, by way of illustration, for example, if we change, well, of course, this is just textual in the Delta Plan. This is not regulatory, Mr. Stevens, not regulatory. Okay. So we can modify this without requiring a recirculation and so on and so forth. Mr. Fiorini, you had some thoughts about how to bring up this appointment stuff, and I believe you were going to do another update at the June council meeting. And I wonder, Mr. Natoli, whether flagging this issue, instructing the references, Mr. Damrell indicated in the executive summary, to acknowledging the desirability of including locals, and scheduling a longer discussion with specific options for the implementation committee in June would be acceptable to you.
Just as you've described it, I don't think, because at that point you're not precluding. Again, I just, you know, and if it's, you know, by reference that you call out certain and you still leave the door open, I think that's, you know, and Randy just shot me a note here about how you might do that. I think there are ways of doing that and having meaningful beyond the work group, and so the committee that we're calling out here, and I could, you know, that's what I understood, and that's why I raised the issue, was that we were coming back in June, and then I took this quick look at this executive summary for the first time with that context, and I'm thinking, you know, that may close the door, because now it's an executive summary, and then you get this specific reference. I'd seen page 49 before, and I kind of had the door open, but
so,
I mean, elevates it, and I would be okay with that.
Okay. Chris, I don't know the procedure on this, since it's not regulatory in nature. Is it a motion you want to have? Can I just state an understanding?
Yeah, you can state it, and we'll have
the members.
Council
let me see if this would satisfy you. Number one, executive assembly will make reference to the presence of local agencies or agencies in the implementation committee. Randy, just check me out. Number two, at the June council meeting, during the report on implementation committee activities, which has already been scheduled, one of the issues for discussion would be options and alternatives on committee membership. Don?
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah.
Okay, so my suggestion is, if that's good enough, everybody seems to be on. Any objection to the council on that? Okay, in whatever format, at least it ought to appear in the minutes of our meeting, of this meeting, those directions agreed unanimously by the council members. So, okay, good. All right. Now, can we go to the Delta Plan?
Sure.
Okay.
Do you have anything you need to say?
Huh?
Do you have anything you need to say?
Oh, well, I was going to ask, what was the council's pleasure?
Yeah, council members, you know, this version of the Delta Plan, which I count as the ninth version of the Delta Plan, reflects the changes we directed at the March meeting, and I guess the April, were there one or two things at the April meeting?
No, actually the April meeting was focused on the executive summary, so in the March meeting.
All right. There were undoubtedly some grammatical and
yes,
pagination and chart
some
names
formatting
and resources
and
that were other changes. I don't know whether any member has questions on the blue line changes in this or not.
And I'm happy to maybe walk through really quickly if that makes sense. I mean, you've covered it, but...
Do you want to walk through any of them or all of them, or what do you want to do?
I would suggest that we respond to questions. I mean, we've got a 240-page report that's got a variety of changes in it. So
let me just organize it this way. Council members, if you would turn to Chapter 1, which is the introduction, and let's see if there are any questions on that. I suspect there probably won't be, but let's just see if there are questions. On Chapter 1, my understanding is you're still working on the color resolution in the charts and all the other stuff that goes with it.
Right.
And you
yes
have authority to clean that stuff up for visibility and understanding, right?
Yes, and we'll be asking again as part of the resolution today to continue with
you're
that authority
right
to make
okay
final edits.
I should probably make one notation. On page 22, you, on the chart, figure 1.4, which is the Delta Plan, city and county general plans, the note you've added, the graphic has been modified from the final draft Delta Plan to make a stylistic correction. I had not a clue as to what that meant.
Largely what that means is color. We're starting to move towards consistent color schemes for the final product.
Because that comment repeats itself in a number of places.
It does. Okay. So, and also what it means is we tried to get the maps to look a certain way and figures to look a certain way, so we would pull text out of the figures and put them underneath. So it really is a formatting.
Okay.
Cindy, as a point of clarification, the changes that we're looking at in the Delta plan, are those that the council hasn't seen before, are the errata sheets. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. So the point being that any changes that we're looking at in the plan now, without going to the errata sheet, are things that the council discussed and made in March.
Yeah. Right.
So the only thing that's new are the errata sheets.
Right, right. And maybe I'll add just one point. And it's not anything new, but you, the conforming changes to the policies. So you voted on modifications to the regulatory text. You saw that a certain way. We have pulled that that same language into the Delta plan. So that it looks different. And as you go through the policies, they now look just like the regulations. Right. But you have seen those.
Okay. Don?
Yeah, on that same page that the chair was on page 22, then you did add all the descriptions, which basically tie back. It makes a verbal reference, written reference to all these general plans or plans that are in place. That is new from what this graphic showed before.
That's that showing in terms of showing the sources?
Yes.
I suspect, yes.
Yes, and then again, the text may have been located in a different place, and so if it got moved, it's going to show up as blue as well.
Well,
so.
I actually looked at some of the footnotes, and what you've done is you've standardized the way you reference sources.
Yes.
So there are a lot of changes that delete Department of Water Resources and substitute DWR. And I think, you know, I'm not sure about the source note on that chart, Don, but my suspicion is the changes use the standardized language. I am certain there have got to be a couple of other places where you're going to make similar kinds of technical changes on.
Yes.
And if I could then, though, the references there where you cite, such and such jurisdiction, 2010, 2011, you have an A and B, those referenced in A and B in the maps are in the back of the plan?
Those would reference the citations that are at the references at the end of the chapter.
On page 27. So that's where you'll see those.
So that takes you back here to this, in the same chapter?
Yes.
Okay. I didn't know.
And just remember, each chapter is set up that way. And so there may, again, be some conforming changes between how we've cleaned up the sources and the citations on the maps and the figures. And if there was anything we changed, you'll see it in the references at the end of each chapter.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Other questions in Chapter 1? Okay. Chapter 2, members. Chapter 2, again, introductory section. You've seen most of the language. I just want to clarify one understanding. Mr. Stevens, on page 59, this is... when you talk about policy number one, governance policy one, we've simply taken the language that refer to regulatory sections and cross-referenced it. You know, it now says 23 CCR section 50024, right?
That's right. It's verbatim from the regulations.
Okay. All right. Don?
Yeah, on page 55.
55.
And this kind of goes to some of the conversation this morning on CEQA and what applies, COCO goals and so forth. Could you take just a moment then and talk about you get the red line taken out, and now you have some language that kind of goes on a bit about what a substantive positive or negative impact is, and then you also call out some of the categories that would be either exempt or wouldn't come under some of the covered action application. But I was specifically interested right under 4, where you've got the black text, actually two different fonts. Well, one is because it's calling out the header, but then you go into the blue versus the red. Could you just take a moment and explain.
On page 57, you have deleted language under administrative exemptions. You have transferred the language back to page 55, slightly editing the opening sentence, is what I recall that being.
Yeah, I think I might refer to our counsel on this matter. I think, you know, what we've tried to do in this section is describe how people would determine if an action is covered, and part of that has to do with whether it will have a significant impact on the achievement of the co-equal goals or on a flood control program.
That's absolutely right. So basically what we did, and this was as part of the modified regulatory package that we saw several months back, is we decided to take categories of projects that the council had decided wouldn't have a significant impact for purposes of the definition of covered action, and more appropriately place those categories of projects actually within the definition of significant impact, because it made it a lot easier to follow, rather than calling them administrative exemptions from the definition of covered action. So you recall that our analysis since day one has always been looking at certain types of categories of projects, for instance, those that might be exempt from CEQA, ministerial projects, those kinds of things, going way back, you know, 2 years from now, previously when we were talking about what the impact would be vis-a-vis the co-equal goals. And so we came up with a list of categories, including one-year water transfers, that we will probably talk about later. But in any event, this was basically taking that text and more appropriately placing it within the context of the actual definition that it applied to.
So as the chair said, you moved a good portion of it from 57 over to 55 and then spilling over to 56, but you also refined it a bit. Or is it a little bit?
Yeah, the definition of significant impact itself was refined, and again, that was part of the modified regulatory package as well. And again, all this was in response to stakeholder comments, and we had some good comments that we had included some terms that weren't defined or listed some categories of potential projects that had beneficial or negative impacts, and the stakeholders had actually suggested that we try to clarify and make it more concise, which we did.
Okay. Other questions on Chapter 2? Other questions on Chapter 2? Okay, members, off to Chapter 3, please. This is the water reliability section. Just to show you how minor it is, on page 75, figure 3.1, how California's water is used, chart, just a notation, and I'm not sure what you've decided. Where all the lines are shown over on the left-hand column, it says evaporation, 115 million acre feet. I thought it was evaporation and evapotranspiration collectively, but I don't remember. I just saw it, and I said, it's something that...
You are correct.
Pardon?
It should be evapotranspiration.
Okay. Sure. If that's the case, then these terms are important. Check that if you would. It's nothing I want to move on in correction, but I rely on the staff to make the check the facts and make the policy determination. Can I ask you a question about another chart on page 94? This is the Freudian slip. This is the historical delta inflow and delta exports chart. God, those colors are murky. I mean, you got to work to figure out what they are. I don't know what we can do, but it just caught my attention that if you were reading it on this side, it's hard to see. I understand much higher resolution on a screen with the electronic version. All right. Other questions, Don?
No, just you drew attention to that chart. I had noted it previously. So you, in the red line, you just, now that reads under figure 3.3, mm-hmm. It's just black text with the blue and then ends at inflows. Is that?
Yes.
And was any of that, was just taken, that text was all taken out below that? I mean, not just here, but it was moved elsewhere. That's the other thing I had a little tough time following, but got moved you know, may have gotten redlined here, but then it got moved over to some other part of the plan. But that's out of there altogether.
That is out. I'm looking to see if Martha's here. I don't believe we moved that anywhere else, but she and I worked together on that piece, so I can pull her up and we can double check.
I know we had some conversation about it previously, but okay. Thank you.
Okay. Pat.
If it's timely, I wanted to ask about in the amended version whether we're clear on what reduced reliance means in terms of absolute reduction in quantity of water or reduction in the percentage or relative dependence on delta water.
Let's go to the section. Point us, if you would, please, to the section.
Well, I think on page 110 there.
109, 110.
Yep.
Right.
If while Dan is looking at this, let me amplify the question a little bit. We understand, based on the work that we've done, that there will be some agencies above and below the Delta that will exhaust their conservation and water management practices, but reach a point where they will, to accommodate growth, require more water. And their only source may be the Delta. So we acknowledge early on that there will be a few agencies that will not be able to reduce the amount of water used from the Delta over time. The comments on the environmental document substantiated that and said that it will not require a reduction in the amount of water taken from the Delta or used from the Delta. But there are, and we've met with some agencies that have laid out their case and said, look, we don't have a groundwater supply, we don't have this, we don't have that. As our population grows, this is the only place we have to turn given current supply scenarios. Do they have adequate comfort in the way the policy is written?
Well, I think that would be a question.